coming up, Preksha, Jain, and Prashantu, Priyanshu. Okay. So the topic they'll be working us today is on Chaos Engineering. Prashantu works currently as a senior technical DevOps lead at Lenskart. Same as with Preksha, she is a DevOps engineering working at Lenskart. I would like to give them a warm welcome and over to you guys.
Yeah, thanks for the intro, Sarita. So good morning, one and all who are present over here. So today our topic would be, just a second, let me share my screen. Yes, so is my screen visible?
No. Yeah.
Okay. So today we would be presenting on Chaos Engineering 101. So this is Preksha Jain. So I have been working at Lenskart as a DevOps engineer from last 4 months. Earlier, I worked as a developer. So I always wanted to explore my potential in different things. So maybe that is why the reason from that I took a shift from developer to DevOps engineer. So here I am exploring my potential as a DevOps and Chaos engineer at Lenskart. And this is my co-presenter, Prashantu. Prashantu, can you give a brief intro about yourself?
Yeah, sure. Hi, all. Very warm welcome. Myself, Prashantu Priyansu. I'm currently working as DevOps engineer at Lenskart. I have been in this industry since last 1.5 years, and I love to contribute in open source project and explore that. So the flow of this presentation is like Preksha will make us understand what are the chaos engineering and how it works, then followed by a demo by me. So over to you, Preksha.
Yeah, thanks, Prashantu. So basically, chaos engineering, nowadays chaos engineering is very much booming. And one must wonder what is chaos engineering, what is the importance of chaos engineering, and how to start chaos engineering at your infrastructure or at your company. So starting with chaos engineering is the discipline of experimenting on a system in order to build confidence in the system's capability to withstand turbulent conditions in production. This is the standard definition given by principlesofchaos.org. So basically, what happens, sometimes a developer fails to build a system which can tolerate failures due to some deadlines or lack of expertise or any other reason. So here is the point where a chaos engineer comes into an action. So basically, challenging your own infrastructure so that it could withstand the conditions of failures in production is chaos engineering. Chaos engineering was introduced by Netflix when Netflix took their system in live. So they found some glitches and they found out a way to solve that glitches in staging environment or in pre-prod environment. So they introduced chaos engineering. After that, many big companies like Google, Microsoft, Amazon started using chaos engineering in their own way. What is the importance of chaos engineering? We all know that sometime or the another, our system will fail instead all the efforts that we put, but sometimes our system fails. So rather than waiting for our system to fail, it's good to reproduce that system failure so that we could get a better output when in production. Finding the weakness in the architecture and services. So by performing chaos experiment, one can find how their architecture or their service would fail in the production. So it's good to like find out the what are the weakness in our architecture or in our service beforehand so that we can work on that weakness and improve our system. Then next is measuring the resiliency of the service and scoring them using a resiliency score. So what do we mean by resiliency over here? Resiliency is basically the system's ability to tolerate failures while still ensuring adequate quality of service. So basically, we want to ensure that our system has this quality, like we provide this quality to our customers. So when we do chaos engineering, we find out that glitches that we are lacking over here. So we can measure the resiliency of a service, and we can score them using the resiliency score. Orchestrating system slowness and failures using a series of experiments and make them a part of continuous improvement. Like if we know what is the failure in a system or what things cause the slowness in a system, so we can continuously improve that and make a system more interactive or more good to the customer. So these are the basics importance of chaos engineering. Now, how can we get start with chaos engineering at our own infrastructure? So in that, the very first point is define SLI or SLO for that particular service. So what is SLI and SLO? SLI means service level indicators, and SLO means service level objectives. So SLO is basically the expectations, like what do we expect from a system? So we write our expectations that we expect this to meet our goal. And SLI is basically the real number that our system is giving us, the actual measurement of what a service or a system is providing us. So it is very necessary to define SLI or SLO for that particular service. And the next is pick a service which is very trivial to business impact. This we can relate in our real life too. Like whenever we start something new, we always started with small amount or with a very small objective. Then we move to big scales. So here also we follow same thing. We start with a service which has the minimal impact on our business. So like if we perform a chaos experiment, so if that experiment went completely wrong or something big happens, so it won't impact our business to that extent. So it is very necessary to find out that service which has the minimal impact on our business. Next is define the scope of chaos experiment. A scope of chaos experiment means like the services, the service on which we want to perform a chaos experiment. So like what are the other features related to it? What factors are affected by that service? Like network latency, CPU utilization, memory, disk, many other factors. So we can define that scope. This service would have this scope. Then next is write the hypothesis for the chaos experiment. To write the hypothesis is very important, because hypothesis is basically like you are defining your steady state of the system. We want our service to perform like this. And another thing is, like, we can in hypothesis we also cover the dependencies on that particular service, like which other services or which like what database is linked to the service, which other services are linked to that particular service on which we want to perform the chaos experiment, and how would they be affected. Like if we do something on this service, how those other services would be impacted, or how our database would be impacted. So it is very necessary to write all those hypotheses. Then the next point is execute the experiment on the service or infrastructures. Once we have defined our scope and wrote all our hypotheses, then we can safely execute a particular experiment that we want to execute on that service or on the infrastructure. Next is measure the impact of the experiment. Then we measure the impact of the experiment, like we executed this service. So what impact we get from after executing that experiment, like our system failed or it passed that experiment. Next is passing the feedback to the relevant team. Once we have done all this, we have executed our chaos experiment, we pass the feedback to the relevant team, like what impact did this chaos experiment give us. So this is basically how we can start with our chaos engineering. Then next is, what are the different tools that we can use? So these are like I have over here covered a little tools only, but there are many tools in the market. So the first one is AWS Fault Injection Stimulator. AWS Fault Injection Stimulator is like fully managed service for running fault injection experiment on AWS, so that one can improve application performance, observability, and resiliency. Next is Kiosk Toolkit. Kiosk Toolkit is basically a free and open source toolkit, and it is basically an API to all the various Kiosk experiments. Like, we can find the APIs to all the various Kiosk experiments in Kiosk Toolkit. Next is Litmus. Litmus is basically a framework for Kubernetes environment that enables user to run their test suites, capture logs, generate report, and execute Kiosk test. Basically, it is used as a stateful set workloads for Kubernetes. Next is Pumba. Pumba is Kiosk testing and network emulsion for Docker containers and clusters. Kiosk Monkey. In the starting, when I was explaining what is Kiosk Engineering, I said Netflix was the first one to start Kiosk Engineering. So Kiosk Monkey is a tool developed by them only. So basically, it is a resiliency tool that helps application tolerate random instance failures. Then next is Gremlin. Gremlin is a Kiosk Engineering platform that supports testing on Kubernetes cluster. It is also another tool used for Kubernetes cluster. For this conference, for this session, we would be focusing on Litmus tool. We are using Litmus tool. In fact, in our company too, we use Litmus only. So this is the architecture of Litmus. So this SRE is the one. SRE over here, I would say that it is me, the person who wants to execute the Kiosk experiment. On the left side, you can see over here, we have downstream applications and application. This is basically, you can define it as our infrastructure or the service on which we want to execute the Kiosk experiment. And on the right side, we have App Community and Kiosk Hub. This is basically from where we will get our Kiosk experiment, like what Kiosk experiment that we need to execute. We will get it from Kiosk Hub. App Community is basically it is a community of members who come and place their experiments over here and consume those experiments. And experiments are placed at Kiosk Hub, as the name already suggests. Kiosk Hub, it is the hub where all the Kiosk experiments are placed. So what happens? The main part over, I'll explain firstly Kiosk Operator and Kiosk Monitor. Kiosk Operator is the middle layer between Kiosk Runner and Kiosk Engine. So basically, it watches Kiosk Engine CR and launches Kiosk Runner. This is the work of Kiosk Operator. Kiosk Monitor is completely optional. Like, if you want to monitor your Kiosk experiment in the form of graph or in form of something, so then you can use Kiosk Monitor. It is completely optional. Kiosk Engine. Kiosk Engine is basically, it contains main two parts. First is where your experiment needs to be executed, in the sense your service, and what experiments need to be executed. That is the experiment that comes from the Kiosk Hub. As soon as we define these two requirements in Kiosk Engine, it is defined in a YAML file. So a kioskengine.yaml file is created, in which all this information is contained, like where the experiment needs to be run and what experiments need to be run. As soon as we run this YAML file, Kiosk Operator comes into action, and it launches Kiosk Runner. And as soon as our Kiosk Runner gets launched, it will create experiments job. Like, if you have defined if you want to perform just one experiment, then only one job will be created. And if you want to define multiple experiment, if you want to run multiple experiments, then multiple jobs gets created. This experiment job is the actual Kiosk experiment, like the actual job that is run. So this experiment jobs is run on your application. It communicates with your application and do the needful, like whatever experiment you want to conduct. So it will communicate with the application and run that experiment. So when we run that, we will show in demo too, like as soon as we run our kiosengine.yml file, you will see a kios runner pod will get created for that particular experiment. So as soon as our experiment gets completed, a kios result is generated, and that result we can pass on this result and check whether our system failed or passed when we performed that kios experiment. And apart from that, we can, if our system gets failed, we can even check the detailed information too, like where our system failed and what is the reason that our system got failed. So this is the basic architecture of Litmus. Now I would like to hand over to Prashanto for demo.
Thank you, Preksha, for this great presentation. Now, let me share my screen. It's visible, right?
No, not yet. Yes.
Okay. Let me start with the what we need to start the kios operation. So basically, we have to first install the Litmus kios operator in the our Kubernetes cluster, and then followed by we have to pull the experiment from the kios hub and set a service account and construct a kios engine manifest file, and then we can apply the kios engine to start the experiment. So so here I am applying the kios operator manifest file to our Kubernetes cluster. So you can verify with the this command. In the Litmus namespace, there is a pod created kios operator. Okay. And we have some more custom resources with the name of kios. So we can verify this as well, like kios engine, kios experiment, and kios result. So basically, kios engine is a one which manages the complete experiment and schedule it. An experiment where we run a manifest file, and kios result is where we generate a result after the kios experiment is done. So now we can install we can install some of the kios experiment from the kios hub. So here you can see that I have installed pod network loss experiment, node restart, and container auto scale, and like pod delete and pod CPU hog experiment. So here we can basically focus on the pod delete experiment, where we delete our pod. You can check that we have some 5 pods of Elasticsearch container. Okay, so we delete one by one or extensively delete the pods and check what is the impact in this cluster. So we can verify this whether your experiment is installed or not. So you can verify with the command called kubectl kios experiment, and whatever the namespace is there, you can choose. So here we can see that many experiment are installed there. We can focus on the pod delete experiment. So for this, we have to create a first service account so that we can run our experiment. So here we can say any we can write any name like pod delete sa, and whatever the namespace is, you have to mention there. Like I have entered the ES namespace, and I am using the role binding here. There are two types of Litmus service account, we can use the admin mode as well as namespace mode. Here I am using the namespace mode. So I am using the role binding with the same namespace. So basically, now I am applying this service account to the ES namespace. We can verify the there are two service account is created. One is default and one is or delete SA. Okay. After that, we have to we can verify our stateful set like quick start ES default. It is our stateful set which is running 5 pod container. So we can annotate this stateful set to minimize the blast radius. If we don't annotate this and we have other cluster with the name of quick start, so it also get impacted. So here we can annotate our stateful set with the name litmus.kiosk.io. Kiosk is equal to true. So in that case, only which is true, kiosk is true. We perform kiosk engine perform only there. Now, let me show the demo. What is pod delete experiment? So I am forwarding my port to local. And watches the node as well as. So here you can see that our 5 node is working and a quick start ES default 2 is the master node right now. So what we can see that. Here we can see that the right now I have 5 pods. So now I am applying my pod delete manifest file. So first view the what is inside the pod delete manifest file. So here you can see that the API version is kiosk litmus.io and the kind is kiosk engine. Okay, you can name whatever you want like metadata name, and you have to mention the namespace there. So in which namespace you want to install this kiosk engine. After that, the main thing is here, app namespace, app labels, and app kind. So here my app namespace is ES, and my app labels is the stateful set app labels. I put it here, and the app kind is my stateful set. Okay, and I annotate is true. I then the annotate is true. And here is the main thing, which service account is used by this kiosk engine. So I mentioned the pod delete SA, which we created earlier. And here is the main thing, what duration you want to perform this kiosk operation. I mentioned there, we want to perform the kiosk operation till 30 seconds. And what is the interval? So here I mentioned that interval of 3, but let me increase it. So by the interval of 10, we can see that the 3 kiosk operation is performed, 10, 10, and 10 in the interval of 30 seconds. Now I have saved this operation. And here you can see that a kiosk engine runner is created. After that, the pod delete experiment is created. Now you can see that the one Elasticsearch container is terminating, and after 10 seconds, another pod is terminated. Now the second pod is terminated. You can check the cluster health with this command. Like our cluster health is yellow, it means it is not as per the standard. Your cluster health should be green, and we have only right now three pods. Now it's four. So here we can see that if we increase our blast radius, and let me like if we put it at five, interval of five. So where what happened, we can see here. So we can see that another kiosk runner is created, and pod delete container is created. Right now our cluster health is green, but after few seconds, a pod is terminated. A second pod is terminated. Now our third pod is terminated. So here you can see that our quick start default 2 is a master node. After this is terminated, like here you can see that this is terminated, our connection is lost. Our connection is lost here. We can't access the nodes as well as indices of the Elasticsearch container, and cluster health is red. So here we can say that if our master node is terminated, so our connection is lost in Elasticsearch container. So we have to replicate our master node to 2 or 3, and we can plan in this way as well. So let me again start the port forward. And now you can see here. Now the third pod is promoted as a master node right now. So our master switch is automatically done, but if the master node is terminated, our connection is lost. So we have to plan in this way, like if we, and how we overcome the disaster recovery if our master node goes down. So we have to HA the master node as well as maximize the our slave node so that we have minimal impact of if any pod goes down. So basically kiosk engine experiment actually show us what happens if something goes wrong. So we can prepare with this. Yeah. Yeah, I'm done with my presentation. Any question?
Yeah, so we'll take up the questions.
Definitely.
Okay, hi. We have few questions. What are some of the experiments that Lenskart predominantly runs?
Like in this infrastructure, we use the CPU hog as well as pod delete experiment and network latency experiment, so that we can leverage our infrastructure and increase the infrastructure availability, like 7, 9, and 8, 9. So we are maximize our pod delete and CPU hog network latency experiment we are focusing on. Any other question? Yeah, exactly. It is a preventive check.
how chaos engineering is different from load testing?
Actually, load testing is you have checked the increase the load and what your infrastructure is behaving in if the load is increased. But in that case, if your pod goes down, suddenly your pod goes down or your network is not available there. So what happens in your infrastructure? You can actually replicate the same thing with the help of chaos engineering.
Does it also suggest corrective actions? Yes, as we just saw now in this pod delete experiment, like our master node went down. So from that, we can conclude that we need to take some actions, like as soon as the master goes down, instead of taking the downtime in production, we should do something in order ki as soon as the master goes down, some other node act as the master node, so that our system doesn't go down.
Yes, we can leverage the pipeline with the chaos engineering as well. DevOps can integrate this as well. So you can leverage the chaos engineering benefits in your pipeline, in your complete pipeline flow. So you can do this as well. Yes. Let me share my screen again. You can see the chaos experiment result as well. Here, here you can see that in the same namespace, a result is created with the name of chaos engine and the pod delete. So you can describe this. So here you can see that the what are the results of your chaos experiment you have done in your infrastructure. Like 46 minutes ago, we have wait and passed the experiment, and pod delete is result is passed and awaited. You can see the result with the name of chaos result litmus.io. You can check with this. Any other question?
Yes. Yes, it would really help like if we execute, if we take chaos engineering into our companies or into our infrastructure, like as I already explained, if we run these experiments before our system went live, we can detect all the glitches or the abnormality like on all the things that we need to work on to provide more better infrastructure. Any other questions?
Yeah, monitoring tool helps you if your system goes down in production, and chaos engineering work help you to actually simulate the same if your project production environment goes down, what happens then, when, what you can do. So it is a simulation, and a monitoring tool helps you if your production goes down. So it is a preventive measure.
So well, I guess that's it.
Yeah. Thank you, Preksha and Prashantu, for the wonderful session. Thanks.